मॉर्निंग डियर स्टूडेंट्स, आई एम मिस नविदा शेख फ्रॉम बृहन मुंबई महानगर पालिका MCGM वर्चुअल क्लास. आई वेलकम ऑल माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स टू अनदर एन इंटरेस्टिंग सेशन. इन टुडे सेशन वी विल बी लर्निंग समथिंग न्यू एंड इंटरेस्टिंग फ्रॉम अ साइंस टेक्स्ट बुक. सो लेट्स गेट. गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, आई वेलकम ऑल माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स टू अनदर एन इंटरेस्टिंग सेशन. एंड टुडे सेशन वी विल बी लर्निंग अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग चैप्टर फ्रॉम योर साइंस टेक्स्ट बुक, दैट इज द लिविंग वर्ल्ड. In it, we'll be learning about adaptation and classification. Now, I'm Ms. Naveda Sheikh. I'll be teaching you all what exactly is the meaning of adaptation and classification. Okay, so it is very important because we have so many types of animals and plants in our surrounding earth. And some plants are colorful, some trees do not have flowers only. They have some plants grow in water, some are found in desert regions where there is no water and very less amount of water is available. Whereas some plants are found only in snowy regions. Some plants cannot be seen without our naked eyes. We need microscope to observe it because they are very minute, whereas some are huge in size. Like plants, animals too have diversity. Diversity means there is a huge variety in them. Means there are different types of animals and plants. Some are unicellular, others are multicellular. Some are vertebrates, whereas others are invertebrates. Now the meaning of vertebrates and invertebrates is related to the spinal cord. And we have learned this in our 6th standard. Okay, so you need to recollect that. This world is full of a variety of animals living on land, that is terrestrial, living in water, that is aquatic, amphibians, which live in water and land both, reptilians, aerial, that fly, etc. Okay, so here you have to observe this. In this picture, you see so many different types of plants. The first thing that we'll be discussing today is related to plants. Okay, now adaptation is a simple word, but it is new to you. So I will just show you all a few pictures and then we will discuss about it. Now there are two images in front of you. One is a snowy region and the other a plant which grows in the dry region where you have very less amount of water, or you can say it grows in a desert region. Now, are the plants and animals from Kashmir and Rajasthan of the same type? So, your answer will be no, because the plants which are growing in Kashmir are made over there. They grow there because the region over there, the climatic condition is very different as compared to the climatic condition which is in the Rajasthan region, where it is very dry. There is the sand is not as moist as compared to the other region in Kashmir. Okay, you have lots and lots amount of snowfall over there, whereas here it is very dry. There is no water also. So there is huge difference between the plants and animals, and I hope that you have understood this part. Let's continue with the actual meaning of adaptation in plants. Now, this topic deals with adaptation in plants and animals both. So today we'll be emphasizing more on adaptation. Adaptation, the meaning of adaptation. Adaptation means a gradual change which occurs in the body parts and also in the behavior of organism. Means if a person or an animal is living in a particular region, they tend to develop certain changes in their behavior as well as their body parts, which this adjustment that they do according to the surrounding, this is called as adaptation. Okay, and it takes place over a long period of time. It doesn't take like today I'm going to Kashmir and tomorrow I'll have a thick layer of fur on my skin. No, it happens over a long period of time. Okay, this happens in animals and plants also. So let's understand. Very first thing that we will be doing today, that the plants, they also adapt according to the environment that they are living in. These are changes that help a plant to survive in that particular environment. Now, suppose if you are let into a snowy region, we live in Mumbai, we live in Maharashtra, our region is, we do not have extreme summers or we do not have extreme winters. We have moderate amount of all the climate, right? But if you go to a region like, say, Rajasthan or if you go to Kashmir, you will go there and you need to take so many things along with you. If you're going to Rajasthan, you will take light and light clothes with you. But where you, whereas if you go to Kashmir region, you take woolen clothes with you. Why? Because we need to adjust to that environment. But plants and animals cannot carry such things with them. So what do they do is, there is an, over a period of time, they adapt themselves in order to stay in that particular environment. Okay, so first we will see how plants survive underwater, in the then in the desert, and then where the soil lacks nutrients. Okay, so first there are a few examples. That is, the seaweed is a plant adapted for its underwater environment. Cactus is adapted for the desert environment, right? Then we have Venus flytrap plant, that is adapted for living in soil that doesn't provide enough nutrients. Okay, so we'll be learning about all this in detail. So let's start the very first example, the very first thing that we'll be doing today is adaptation in aquatic plants. Now, if you look at these pictures, there are certain, there are two examples that you can see. First one is a plant which is not fully submerged. It is on the surface of water. Half a part is above and remaining part is below water. Other picture shows that there are a few plants which are fully submerged in the water. So these type of plants are called as aquatic plants. The plants which live inside the water or on the surface of water, near the region of water, means the roots are attached to the undersurface of the water, but the remaining part is above the water level. These all types of plants are called as aquatic plants. Now, the emergent means they are growing in shallow water with leaves or stems above the water surface. Next, you can see floating, like the lotus, which is growing unattached or rooted with floating leaves. The next one is submerged, that is, they are growing entirely below and up to the water surface. You can see the examples here on the screen. Next is the algae that you see, which are floating on the surface of water. That is cellular lower weed form. No distinguished stem or leaf is found in them. Example is moss or algae. So this is, these are a few categories of aquatic plants. Okay. Okay. So in the last slide, we have seen a few categories of aquatic plants. Now, how have they adapted to their environment and how are they different from the terrestrial plants that are there? Now, if you see in this picture, you will see that the stem is not that hard as compared to the plants which are there in the terrestrial region. Okay, they are ribbon-like, they are flexible. Why is it so? Because they can withstand the water currents. When the water, there's a water current which is very extremely fast, means when the water starts to flow, and that could damage the plant if the stems are hard. Okay, so that is the reason the leaves and the stems are thin and ribbon-like. Next, the entire surface of the leaf or the plant of aquatic plants are mostly covered with a waxy layer, okay, which does not allow it to fully submerge into water, and if the water falls onto it, it rolls off because it has a waxy coating over it. Okay, and this is also one more reason why the plants, even if they are inside, even if they are submerged in the water or on the surface of the water, they do not rot. Rot means sadte nahi hai bolo. Theek hai? Why? Because of this layer that they have. Next is how do they keep floating? Because if you put something, it tends to go inside the water. But these plants float. How are they able to float? Because they have air spaces in their stems and their petioles. Okay, which helps them to be light in weight, and that is the reason they can float easily on the surface of water, as well as when they are submerged inside, they can easily move around, because what happens is with the help of the water current, they tend to move easily because they are very light. Okay, so with this, I hope the adaptation of plants. Okay, so in aquatic plants, we have to remember that they have adapted themselves to live in fresh water as well as salt water. First, we'll take an example of the seaweed. It is an aquatic plant. It is adapted for underwater life. These plants have air bubbles in them, in their leaf, which helps them in the exchange of oxygen from the water to the plant. It also helps keep the seaweed upright because of the air bubbles that are there in them. Okay, the leaf of underwater aquatic plants are also softer than the above ground plants. As I told you earlier also, this softness allows the plant to move easily with the waves without breaking. There are a few things that we need to remember when we talk about adaptation. They have firmly rooted in soil and submerged stems. Some plants entirely remain afloat, means पूरी तरीके से पानी के ऊपर रहते हैं, बिल्कुल भी नीचे नहीं, without floating roots, while some are submerged in water. Stems and petioles are soft, flexible, leaves and flowers float on water. Some plants have thin, ribbon-shaped, slender leaves. This is an adaptation to withstand fast current of water. Leaf and stem coated with waxy layer and air spaces inside the stem and leaves are much as clear. Chalo, let's take a few examples of aquatic plants. Now, this is water lily, which grows rooted, has rooted bottoms with leaves and afloat that float on the water surface. Then you have Pistia stratiotis, an example of a plant that floats freely on the water surface. Then this Ceratophyllum is a plant which it is free floating plant that was completely submerged in the water. This is a liverwort which grows either submerged or on. The next and a very interesting thing that we are going to do today is plants in the desert. Now, when you talk about desert, the first thing comes too much of dryness and sand, too much of the temperature will be very high, right? There will be no plant, and that is actually true. When we plants in desert, it is a very extreme climate where the plants do not get sufficient amount of water. Okay, there is scarcity of water, and even in such harsh conditions, the plants have adapted to live there. Now, how have they adapted? We'll study that. Now, deserts are the home to many living things. In fact, deserts are second only to tropical rainforests in the variety of plants and animal species that live there. Here you can see a cactus. This is also another example of a succulent. How do you think plants grow in a place that is very, very dry? Many of the fascinating features of desert plants are adaptations. They have a few characteristics which is very important and very interesting also. How are they surviving in such harsh environment? They have the ability to collect water and store water. They have features which reduces water loss, like they do not have leaf like other plants have. Instead, they have spines, and they have thick stem which helps in storage of water and food. Okay, and because they have spine, they have thorn-like structures that you can see. These help in reduction of water. Okay, so the roots of the desert plants penetrate deep in the soil in search of water. They have a thick layer of waxy substance on stem, which helps to avoid loss of water because of evaporation. They have leafless or leaf-like small needles. These leaves have been modified into thorns for conserving water. Very little water is lost by evaporation because of that. The stems are fleshy as water and food is stored in them. Okay. Modified stems perform photosynthesis and hence are green. Example is cactus and acacia. These are a few examples of cactus, different varieties of cactus, star cactus, finger cactus, jade cactus, saguaro cactus. Alright. So this is a gist of what we have learned about the adaptation of desert plants. The plants that live in deserts are adapted to reduce the amount of water they lose because they have modified their leaves into thorn-like structures. Okay, so that water doesn't get lost easily. Then they have thick stem which helps them to store water and food in them. Okay, so these are a few things, simple things that you need to remember in mind when you are learning about plants. You can see few examples of desert plants here. Quite interesting, right? Next is adaptation in snow region plants. Now when we talk about adaptation in snow region plants, first thing comes, it is so cold over there. How are the plants surviving? Right? So again, plants have adapted themselves to survive there as well by having a particular shape in them. They have a conical structure. Okay, if you see this example here on the right hand side, you will see that conifers like deodar and pines are seen in snowy regions. These trees have conical structures with sloping branches. Means hamare jo normal branches hote hain, they are widespread, but here they are in a sloping position. Why? Because when the snow falls, it doesn't settle over it. It falls off. Okay? So due to heavy snowfall and extreme cold weather, such adaptations are seen. The conical shape prevents accumulation of snow on the tree. They also have thick bark, which helps the tree to withstand the cold. Okay, like how we the animals in the cold region have thick layer of fur, the barks are very thick because they need to protect the internal part of the plant as well. Okay, so these are a few things you need to remember, the few adaptations that the plants in the snowy region have adapted themselves. The next one is adaptation of plants in forest region. Now when we talk about forest, forest means you first imagine lots and lots of plants over there, right? And it is correct also because forests have a huge number of plants and varieties of plant over there, from small tiny algae to huge trees. Okay, so how have they adapted themselves? Let's see. All the plants compete for sunlight because there are so many plants and everybody wants sunlight. So they grow tall. These trees grow tall to capture the sunlight. And here you can see in this picture how tall the trees are growing because the lower region is very, it is in complete darkness over there. And we all have learned that sunlight is important for plants. And in order to get sunlight, they grow tall. Okay, next, a diverse variety of plant trees, herbs, shrubs are seen in the forest. Means you have different levels of plants over there. You have small herbs also, then bigger than that shrubs also, and bigger than those are trees that you see in the forest region. Climbers have adopted by having spring-like tendrils which they seek support from the host tree. Here you can see how are they, the climbers are, they're going around the host plant just in order to take support. Okay, so these are a few adaptations that they have done because even climbers need sunlight and they do not have a huge trunk or a stem which is very strong or they can grow tall. So what do is they wind themselves up around a host plant in order to get sunlight and go above. Okay, so these are a few adaptations done by plants in the forest region. The next is adaptation in grassland plants. So So, when we talk about grasslands, the very first thing comes in your mind is grass. Okay, a land which is covered with grass. There are this land over here. When we talk about grassland, they have various types of grasses. Depending, they might be very tall also. There might be small grasses, but they are very important because it helps in the diversity of animals also. How? I'll be explaining you later. Now, the next thing is we have vast meadows which are found in plain hilly regions. Then it helps in avoiding from prevent it helps in preventing soil erosion because of the fibrous roots of grasses. They are very tall grasses are seen in the equatorial region as different large animals also take shelter in these grasses while hunting. Then you have short grasses also in the cold region where you can find rabbits, which make use of the grass to eat. They eat also and they hide also in there. Okay, it is clear. The next and the very interesting one for today is adaptation for ingestion of food. Now, there are certain plants. Suppose if that particular area doesn't have proper amount of nitrogen in the soil present, there are few plants which take in other insects. They eat insects in order to get the nitrogen or the protein required for them. Okay, so very interesting topic coming up. Now the plants are autotrophic. These plants are also autotrophics, mean they prepare their own food. But as the soil lacks certain amount of nutrients in them, they become parasitic. Okay, parasitic means taking nutrients from the other plant or other organism. Like, for example, first we talk about a plant that is a parasitic plant, means it winds itself around a plant. It penetrates, the roots penetrate into the stem and they take in all the water and food from them and nourish themselves. And on the other hand, they are harming also because they're taking in all the food from the plant that is there. Okay, and that is why it is called as a parasite. Here you can see, because they do not have a leaf, they cannot perform photosynthesis, and hence they have to survive depending upon the other plants. There are hostorial roots for sucking and absorbing nutrients from the host plants. It grows on host. Now here in this image, it is clearly seen how these roots are very fine. You all can see that they are easily penetrating into the other plant, host plant, and they're taking in all the nutrients from it. Okay. Next is fungi. They cannot perform photosynthesis because they do not have chlorophyll, and they obtain food from starchy foodstuffs. You must have seen it on your bread. If you keep bread outside for a very long period of time, and if you open the packet and see, you will see that it has turned green in color or black in color, right? Because these fungus grow over the moist and dead things, okay, rotten things. Roots like fiber are present in them for absorption of food. Now here you can see mushrooms. They are also growing on the decaying organisms, okay, and they take nutrients from them. Because they do not have chlorophyll, they cannot prepare their own food. These are a few examples of fungi. Plants like Drosera, that is sundew plant, Venus flytrap, pitcher plant, etc., they consume insects to fulfill their need for nitrogen. The plants in nitrogen deficient are usually insectivorous plants. Such plants have structural adaptation, means their body is adapted and they have modified in such a way that they attract the insect and then they hold them captive. Matlab, they have fluid in them which attracts the insects and other organisms, and once they enter there, they trap them inside. Okay, like here you can see, this is first one was Venus flytrap, this is sundew plant, which they attract the insect. Once the insects get inside, they quickly catch hold of them. This is a pitcher plant. See. So I hope this with you all, and I hope that you all enjoyed it. So we will meet you in the next coming period. We'll be learning about adaptation in plants in the next coming week. Thank you.
If you like our video, please subscribe to our channel and do not forget to hit the like button.
Hope this session was quite useful to you. In the next coming period, we'll learn something new and interesting. Till then, thank you.